the time complexity of an algorithm. How do you calculate the time complexity of an algorithm? Then we have seen there are different notations that we use to measure the time complexity or to represent the time complexity of any algorithm. And those notations are called as asymptotic notations. So there are three notations available for representing time complexity. That is Big O notation, then omega notation, and then last is theta notation. Big O notation are basically used to always show the upper bound of an algorithm. It is a way to express the upper bound of an algorithm running time. It measures the worst case time complexity or the longest amount of time that is needed by an algorithm to execute. Suppose there are two functions, f of n is our actual time taken by the function for our algorithm to execute, and g of n is the upper bound of it. Then the mathematical expression can be written for Big O notation as O of f of n equal to set of g of n. There exists c, which is constant greater than 0 and n 0, such that always f of n should be less than or equal to c into g of n. That's why if you see into the graph also, f of n line is acting below the for all n greater than 0, n 0. Then we have seen omega notation. It is used to express the lower bound of an algorithm runtime. It is always used for representing the lower bound of an algorithm's running time. It measures the best case time complexity of an algorithm. Or I say that it is the best amount of time taken by an algorithm for its completion. The mathematical expression is written like this: omega of f of n is greater than equal to set of g of n, where there exists c greater than 0 and n 0, such that g of n is always less than or equal to c into f of n for all n greater than n 0. Now if you see into this graph, the actual time taken by of an algorithm is represented by f of n, whereas the lower bound for this algorithm is g of n. So in omega notation, it is always used to express the lower bound of an algorithm's running time. It is always appearing, g of n is always appearing below f of n in case of omega. And the third notation that we used for representing time complexity of an algorithm is theta notation. The theta notation is the formal way to express both the complexities, lower bound and upper bound, best case and the worst case time complexity. It appears in between these two lines, best case and the worst case. So we can say that theta notation is used to represent the average amount of time taken by an algorithm for its execution. Now consider there are suppose three functions, g1 of n, f of n, and g2 of n. Now we can represent the mathematical expression for f of n using theta like this: theta of f of n equals to g of n if and only if g of n equal to o of f of n. It means it is the worst case time complexity, and g of n equal to it omega of f of n. It is your best case time complexity, which appears in between these two ranges for all n greater than n 0. Now if you see into the graph, your time complexity represented by f of n function is appearing in between both the upper bound and lower bound. So theta notation is always, we can say that it is used for expressing the average case time complexity of an algorithm. There are different asymptotic notation that we commonly use to represent different expressions. If an expression is only having constants, so it is constant expression, we can say. For that, by default, you can say that your time complexity is O of 1. It is constant. if your function consists of logarithmic expressions, then the time complexity for executing such thing is O of log n. If your expression is linear, then your time complexity would be O of n. If the function consists of n log n, then the time complexity would be O of n log n. If the function is quadratic, then the time complexity would be n square, O of n square. If the function is cubic, then your time complexity would be O of n cube. If it is inverse to 4, then your time complexity would be O of n inverse to 4, and so on. So it increases according to the power. If the function is polynomial, then the time complexity would be n raised to O of 1. If it is exponential function, then the time complexity would be 2 raised to O of n. Then this question always asked in your company interviews, that you have studied so many algorithms, different algorithms for sorting any numbers, list of numbers given to you. So the algorithms that are available are selection sort, bubble sort, insertion sort, heap sort, quick sort, merge sort, bucket sort, and radix sort. So the question may be asked in your company interviews, what would be the time complexity of any algorithm, any sorting method, which sorting method is best sorting method, which sorting method is worst sorting method in a certain situation. That totally depends upon the time taken by the sorting method for its execution. So if you see in this table, we are given base case time complexity, average case time complexity, and worst case time complexity for each and every algorithm that is mentioned here. Selection sort, the best case time complexity is O of n square. Average case time complexity is represented by theta, so it is theta of n square, and worst case is represented by O of n square. For bubble sort, it is if you pass all the elements as sorted elements to bubble sort, then in that case it is a best case for bubble sort. So the time complexity, best case time complexity for bubble sort is omega of n, whereas average case and worst case time complexities are theta n square and O of n square respectively. Same thing happens with insertion sort. We'll see this in the next PPT, how to calculate these values. No, insertion sort, the best case time complexity is omega of n, average case time complexity is theta of n square, and worst case time complexity is O of n square. Now if you see next three algorithms like heap sort, quick sort, and merge sort, here we actually perform the divide and conquer method. This comes under divide and conquer method. Wherever we do division operation, the complexity is always logarithmic, because we are dividing the entire array into two halves. For heap sort, the best case time complexity is omega of n log n, average case time complexity is theta of n log n, and worst case time complexity is n O of n log n. Quick sort, we do the same thing in quick sort also. It is omega of n log n, average case time complexity is theta of n log n, but the worst case time complexity is O of n square. In merge sort also we divide and conquer. That's why again the best case time complexity is omega of n log n, average case time complexity is theta of n log n, and worst case time complexity is O of n log n. For bucket sort, omega of n plus k, theta of n plus k for average case, and worst case is O of n square. For radix sort, it is O of nk, theta of nk, and O of nk worst is for average case and worst case time complexity. This table is very, very important. Just to remember when to use which notation or when to use which type of function for representing the time complexities. For any constant expression, we are going to use O of 1. Example is given here is odd number or even number. If you want to check whether the given number is even or odd in the program, then such program's time complexity would be O of 1. Lookup table, there also it is O of 1. When we have O of log n time complexity, finding an element on sorted array with binary search. In binary search, as we know, we actually start searching the element from the root node. We'll compare the targeted element with the root node. If it is not matching, we have to go to the left side or we have to go to the right side, depending upon if coming element is, or the search target element is less than or it is greater than the root node. If it is less than the root node, we have to search it into the left side, left subarray, and if it is greater than the middle element, you can say the root element, middle element of the binary search, we have to search that element into right subarray of binary search method. So whenever there is a task of division comes, we represent such algorithms time complexity as O of log n. For linear functions like finding maximum element in unsorted array, we need to search the maximal element into the array. We start our searching from the beginning of the array and we go till the last element, one after the another. We check each and every element. Wherever we get the maximum element, we return that from the array. Then also, finding the duplicate elements in an array with hash map. There also the function is linear function. That's why your time complexity is O of n. Then the combination of linear and logarithmic is called as n log n. Function which consists of linear combination of linear function and logarithmic function. When there is a merger of these two, then the time complexity is always O of n log n. Log n means you are dividing your entire array into two halves, and linear means you are doing certain tasks which is starting with the array first element and it is going till the last element. Then it is linear, correct? So it is a combination of both linear plus logarithmic. That's why the name is given as linear arithmetic. Sorting example, if you see here, sorting elements in an array with merge sort. What we do in merge sort, we divide the original array into sub equal halves so that all the elements becomes individual elements, and later on we actually do sorting while merging those elements. So while sorting, we'll go from first element to the last element, whereas in division we have logarithmic function, right? So it is a combination of both linear plus logarithmic. The next one is quadratic. When you have O of n square time complexity, for example bubble sort, we go, there are two nested for loop, right? In bubble sort, one is for number of passes and another is for actual swapping of two numbers. So swapping of numbers in the bubble sort, because of the two nested for loops, your time complexity is O of n square. Any function or any equation which has three variables like n cube, then their time complexity would be O of n cube. For all exponential functions, like find all subset of a superset, then in that situation, your time complexity would be O of 2 raised to n. Then if your program is to find all permutations and combination of a set or string, subset of a substring, you can say for a main string, how many things are available, substrings are available for a particular string, then that would be all possible permutation combination of that particular string. That comes under the problem for this O of n factorial. So time complexity would be O of n factorial. Finding the factorial of a number is also an example for this time complexity of n factorial. So this ends your introductory part of time complexities. Now we'll move to the next part to find the time complexities of all the sorting algorithms. We have studied this part in data structures also, as well as in analytic algorithm. But we'll again revise it because a question may comes on this topic. Find the time complexity of so and so algorithm, right? They may ask you any algorithm from this. Starting with bubble sort. What happens in bubble sort? In bubble sort, they give us a list of elements. Our job is to sort these elements into ascending order. How the process goes on? We pick the first element of the array and we compare it with the immediate next element. Five gets compared with immediate next element, that is one. And if we found that the first element, the current element, is greater than immediate next element, then you have to perform swap. When to perform swap? If the current element is greater than immediate next element, then we perform swap. So it is, if you see here, the swapping is done. One came to first place and five goes to the place of one. Now we are going to compare five with six. If swapping is needed, now the current value is five and the next value is six. Swapping is not needed here because the current element is not greater than the next element. Then we move to six and compare it with two. When you compare six with two, current number is six, next number is two. Current number is six is greater than two. That's why we need to perform swap. The red line indicates swapping is happening here. Right. So we do swapping and then two will come to the place of six and six will go to the place of two. Now six is compared with four. Again, current value of I is six and next element is four. Current element is greater than next element. So again, we have to do swapping of these two elements. So four will come here and six will go down. Now six is compared with three. Six is compared with three. And what is happening here? See, again, the current element six is greater than the next element three. We need to perform swap. This entire thing is one pass, one iteration. Okay. In every iteration or in every pass, one largest bubble is picked from the array and it will be placed to its proper place. One element, largest bubble will be picked from the array and it will be placed to its proper place. If you see, the largest number six which was there in this array now got its proper place. This is the end of the first pass. When you go to the next pass, which means next iteration, we will ignore six because it is already sorted and we will only focus on this remaining elements 1, 5, 2, 4 and 3. We will not consider 6 because it is already sorted. And we have repeated this thing till all elements get sorted. Now if you see a program on this, how to do the program on this, the simple code we have written here with the variables. We have already seen these programs in our previous subjects like data structure analysis algorithm, I, J and temp. Temp is for swapping of two numbers, I and J for iterations, right, and comparisons. So there are six elements, so I have taken I equal to 0, I less than 6, I plus plus. Then in inner loop, we are writing a condition J equal to 0, J less than 6 minus I minus 1. Semicolon J plus plus. Why we are writing this condition like this here in J loop? Because after every iteration, definitely one largest bubble will be placed to its proper place. So we will ignore that. To ignore that element, we have to write a condition like this. J less than 6 minus I minus 1. I minus 1 is written black for that. Ignoring one element, last element, sorted element. And inside this inner for loop, we are going to check if the current element, that is A of J, is less than, sorry, is greater than A of J plus 1. Whenever this thing happens, if the current element is greater than next element, we have to perform swap. And what is the swapping logic? Temp equal to A of J equal to A of J plus 1, and then A of J plus 1 equal to temp. That we know, correct? So this will go till the last element and the sorting is done. coming back to the time complexities of bubble sort. Now just consider you are in pass one. In first pass, how many comparisons you need to do? Consider there are n numbers into the list, and how many comparisons we need to do in the first pass? Definitely there will be n minus one comparisons, because we need to compare that element, first element, with each and every element of the array till it gets sorted, correct? In the, when you go to the next pass, we are ignoring the sorted elements. So definitely there will be one less comparison in the second pass. So when you go to the second pass, the number of comparisons would be n minus two. When you go to the third pass, the number of comparisons would be n minus three. Like this and so on. In the last iteration, in the last pass, what happens? You have to compare only one element. That's one element. If you add this now, frequencies, these are the frequencies of statements happening or comparisons happening here. If you add all this, you'll get sum equal to n into n minus 1 by 2. It is natural number 6, correct? If you solve this equation, you'll get n square minus n by 2, correct? You'll get n square minus n by 2. You have to pick the largest power from this final answer, that is n square, and that would be your time complexity, worst case time complexity for bubble sort. It is the maximum amount of time taken by bubble sort for its completion. Then what would be the best case time complexity for bubble sort? These are uncertain elements we have given to bubble sort. Suppose we have given sorted, all sorted elements, already sorted elements, then the time complexity would be O of n. Now in insertion sort, as we know, there are two things in insertion sort. One is called unsorted array and another is called sorted array. Consider this example, this diagram. So this is example where you have all unsorted elements given. Every time what you have to do is you have to pick one element from unsorted array and insert it into sorted array to make it sorted list. Okay. We'll see if in every iteration what happens. Consider these elements are given to you 5, 1, 6, 2, 4, 3. In the first pass, what happens? We consider 5, the first element, as sorted element, and rest of the other elements are unsorted. We will pick in every pass, we will pick one unsorted element from unsorted array and insert it into sorted array. While inserting, we actually does sorting. See here, considering 5 is already sorted, we are the first iteration we are inserting by this array. If you see here, one is inserted, when one is inserted, it becomes 1, 5 in the sorted array, correct? Now from 6 onwards, our rest of the things is unsorted. We are inserting 6 into the sorted array. It is already sorted, so your equation becomes, this expression becomes 1, 5, 6, 2, 4, 3. Remaining these three elements are unsorted. Now we'll put 2 into the sorted array, then the sequence changes, so it becomes 1, 2, 5, 6, and 4 and 3 in unsorted elements. In the next pass, we'll insert 4 into the sorted array. We'll get 1, 2, 4, 5, 6, and only 3 is remain into the unsorted array. In the last iteration, we'll also insert 1 into the sorted array, and you'll get the answer as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 as the sorted list. The simple logic of insertion sort. I'll share this PDF with you. You can try this code at your home. Your code is not going to be asked in the examinations. They will ask you how do you calculate the time complexities of these algorithms. Now, what would be the time complexity for this program? Time complexity is again similar to your bubble sort, because if you see, in the first pass, one element is inserted. So one comparison is needed into the first pass. When you insert next element from second iteration, you need two comparisons. When you go to third pass, you insert third number into the sorted array, so you need three comparisons. Likewise, if you go on in the second last iteration, like n minus 2 say, when you insert that element into the sorted array, you need n minus 2 comparisons. When you reach to the last number, when you insert the last number from unsorted array to sorted array, you need n minus 1 comparisons. Now, if you add these again, 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus and so on, n plus n minus 2 plus n minus 1, again your equation becomes n into n minus 1 by 2, which is again a natural number series. Again, if you expand this equation, you will get n square minus n by 2. The largest power of n variable here is n square. That's why the worst case time complexity for again insertion sort is O of n square. Best case time complexity is O of n, and average case time complexity is O of n square. Space complexity is O of 1. So these things they may ask you in your examination. So keep it in mind. Major focus should be on algorithm and time complexities. Now coming to the selection sort, just focus on this table. How we are doing the sorting in selection sort. Now this, you just focus on the first column. In the first column, there are random numbers given to you: 3, 6, 1, 8, 4, and 5. In the first iteration, when you do selection sorting, the first iteration. In first iteration, we always find the smallest number because it is in ascending order sort. We always find the smallest number from the entire array. We get that number from that position. We pick that number and we'll put it at the first place into the array. If you focus on the second column, you will see that 1 is shifted up and 3 is shifted down at the place of 1. Correct? So, sort these two is done. Position sorting, correct? Now, 1 is already sorted, so we'll ignore it. We'll only focus on the rest of the elements 6, 3, 8, 4, and 5. Again, we'll repeat the process of finding the smallest number in the remaining elements, and the smallest element we found is 3. So, we'll go to the second column, just check what is happening there. We are shifting 3 upward and 6 downward, and we assume that 1 and 3 is already sorted, and remaining elements are in unsorted array. So again, you have to pick the smallest element from the list of unsorted array. And what you have to do is, you have to again shift it to the place of 6. And 6 will come. 4 will go up, and 6 will come down. Now your sorted elements are 1, 3, and 4. And unsorted elements are 8, 6, and 5. Again, repeat the same process. Pick the last smallest element from the unsorted array. I shift it upward. Now 5 goes to the place of 8, and 8 will come down to the place of 5. In the fourth column, these elements are already sorted, so we'll only focus on 6 and 8. Now what will happen? 6 will remain to the same place because 6 is less than 8. And in the last fifth column, you'll see all the sorted elements according to selection sort. How many comparisons are needed? Our job is to find the time complexity for this algorithm. Then we will check in the first pass how many comparisons are needed to the first element, first polished element. It is always n minus 1 because we need to compare all elements n minus 1. In the next, to get the next polished element, n minus 2. To get the next smallest element, number of comparisons will be decreased, n minus 3, and so on. In the last pass, we only compare one element. So if you again add all these frequencies or time complexities, you'll get the actual time complexity T of n equal to 1 plus 2 plus and so on n minus 3 plus n minus 2 plus n minus 1. And again, the equation you get is for natural number series. That is n into n minus 1 by 2. So again, if you expand this, it becomes n square minus n by 2. Pick the largest power, that is O of n square. So O of n square is again the time complexity for worst case time complexity for selection. Let's focus on this table given here. Worst case time complexity is O of n square. Best case time complexity is again O of n square. Average case time complexity is O of n square. Your space complexity is O of 1. Any question in first three? These three algorithms are very simple.
where your time complexities of O of n square, all the time, worst case time complexities for all these first three algorithms is O of n square. Any question till now? Students, any questions on this topic? Please write your answer into the chat room. Okay, I got some answers. Good. So Aditya, no, then Ashish is saying no questions. It means you understood, guys, correct? You know how to calculate now the time complexities of all these algorithms. Have you understood? Please answer. Have you understood how to calculate the time complexity for different set of algorithms? Do not unmute your mic. Please write your answer into the chat room. Unmute your mic only when you want to ask me the question. I'll give a chance in last 5 minutes to ask the question. Now, space, very good question. Marmik is asking me, sir, space complexity for every algorithm is O of 1. That depends upon how many variables that you are using actually for the, what is space complexity? It is the number of variables that we use and the actual memory space taken by there. This particular algorithm for its execution. So why it is one? Because we need only how many variables, temporary variable into this, all these algorithms, then I and J, correct? I, J and say the another variable is temporary variable. So suppose I variable and J variable and temp variable, suppose it takes one unit of space, correct? Then what will happen? Your total space taken by three different variables with three units, correct? And what is 3? 3 is a constant. Whenever there is a constant, Marmik, whenever there is a constant, your time complexity is always O of 1. If you get any equation, then only, if you get any equation like n square plus n plus 3, say, then in that case only, your time complexity changes and the time complexity would be O of n square. Space complexity will be O of n square. Very good question asked by Marmik. The space complexities for bubble sort, selection sort, and insertion sort is O of 1. The reason is that the space taken by these variables, if I consider I, J, and temp variable takes one unit of time, one unit of space, then total units taken by these three variables with three units, and three is a constant. The space complexity for constants are always O of 1. Remember this thing. Correct? And now Akhilesh Kumar Yadav is writing something. If time complexity and space complexity is same for all algorithms, then why we study all of them? See, Akhilesh, in certain situation, one algorithm fit better. There are different algorithms developed by the developers. Correct? It is the choice of the developer when we implement the project or the code, he has to pick the best algorithm to sort particular elements. In some situation, the developer thinks that quicksort is fastest sorting technique, and he will do that. And that is totally dependent upon the performance of your software. If space is not the constraint for your project, then you will pick bubble sort or any other sorting method. Now, if your project constraint is that your project should execute the algorithm very fast, then in that case, the time complexity plays the very important role. Then the user has to, or the developer has to, pick an algorithm or sorting method which actually sort your large list of elements within very few milliseconds of time. See, bubble sort, selection sort, and you can see insertion sort, sorting methods works very fine with very less number of numbers in the list. Whereas quick sort and other algorithms like merge sort and many other algorithms, they work with the large list of elements, huge number of data. So if you want your project to run or sort that thing in a faster manner, then quicksort is best. Quicksort is the fastest sorting method. Every algorithm has its own importance, and advantage and disadvantage. If your data which is to be sorted is very less, say it is below 100 numbers, then I'll definitely go for bubble sort. It is simplest sorting method for me, correct? So have you got the answer, Akhilesh? Very, very good question by you also. So I got two nice questions from the students today. Now, shall we move to the next topic now? Well, I have answered the questions of Marmik as well as Akhilesh. Again, I have 15 to 20 minutes remaining. I'll try to cover the next sorting methods. Coming back to the next sorting method, that is quick sort. As we know, the process of quick sort that we have studied in data structures and analysis algorithms also, what we do in quick sort, just quickly revise that. It is the sorting method which comes under divide and conquer method. We actually partition the whole array into two parts. Once the pivot element is placed to its proper place. When the pivot element is placed to its proper place, we actually divide the array into two subarrays, left subarray and right subarray. And we recursively perform quick sort, repeatedly perform quick sort on both the subarrays simultaneously. It means that in one pass, you get your pivot element to its proper place. In the next pass, the quick sort works on two subarrays. In the first part, it works on the whole array. In the next pass, it works on two subarrays. In the third pass, it works on four subarrays. In the next pass, it works on eight subarrays. It means that as the number of passes increases, the division and sorting becomes faster and faster in case of quick sort. So I'll not go into the depth of this, how we do sorting into the quick sort. Rather than this, I'll go directly to the part where we actually do the analysis. You can refer my video on this YouTube regarding this. Okay, I'll explain this how actually we do in only one element, and then you can repeat these things for the rest of the elements, how to do the sorting into quick sort. Now there are three things that we have to remember. We have to pick the first element as the pivot element, or you can pick any element as the pivot element. For our convenience, I have picked 25 as the pivot element, and we want to put 25 to its proper place after first iteration. Then there are two pointers we set. One is up pointer and another is down pointer. Down pointer is set to I, which is at the beginning of the array. Then up pointer is set to j, which is pointing to the last element of the array. We always increment I pointer if and only if the value of a of I is less than pivot element. Okay, we increment I pointer by one if a of I is less than pivot element. It means that the I pointer, that is we can say that is down pointer, will be shifted to right if the pivot element or the coming element is less than the pivot element. This process continues, and it will stop whenever this condition becomes false. When this condition becomes false, it goes to the right side. On the right side, there is up pointer, which is pointed by J. It will always check. This will be decremented by J pointer will be decremented by 1 if and only if A of J is greater than pivot element. Whenever this thing happens, we actually decrease the value of J pointer by 1. So it will move from right to left. So it will be decremented, whereas I will be incremented. If both the sides, suppose both the points are not moving, say, it means I is not moving to the right, whereas J is not moving to left. Both are hanged, right? If both sides, we find the element is not satisfying their respective conditions, then we have to swap. We have to swap the elements pointed by these pointers. we have to exchange the elements of A of I with A of J. When we do this, whenever these two pointers are not moving, I pointer is not moving to the right side, J pointer is not moving to the left side, both are intact, they are not moving, then only we have to swap A of I with A of J. Now the second condition, this is the first condition. Now second condition, whenever the up pointer, that is J pointer, goes below down pointer, that is I, it may happen that J pointer may go down below I pointer. Whenever that happens, immediately you have to shift, you have to swap the pivot element with of I value. Correct. So when this happens, when the second condition is successfully executed, then we can say that the pivot element is reached to its proper place. Is the program on that? I'll share this PDF. You can try this program at your home. This coming to the time complexities of this swapping method. Now, as we discussed in our previous slide, whenever we divide the whole array into two subarrays, your time complexity is always logarithmic. Correct. Whenever you divide the whole array into two halves, then your time complexity would be log n. But with that, we are also sorting. After division, we are also sorting. No. So after division, we are sorting. So it is again take linear function. For sorting purpose, we use linear function. For division, it is logarithmic. Whereas for sorting, it is O of n. It is the merger of both. Is the merger of both. That's why your time complexity would be O of n log n. Best case time complexity and average case time complexity would be O of n log n, which is definitely less than O of n square. So it means that your sorting becomes more faster than our all the previous three algorithms like bubble sort, insertion sort, and selection sort. But in the worst case, what happens? It will take O of n square time complexity. The space complexity is again O of n log n. O of log n, because if you see, the first original array gets divided into two subarrays. It will definitely going to take some more space. Right? So you are dividing also, and you are taking the that many number of memory spaces also. So we are dividing, that's why it is log n, and you are taking same number of memory spaces to store the variable values. If there are n elements, then it will take n spaces, and you are dividing into that, that's why it is log n. The total time space complexity will be O of n log n into this. So you have to remember these four lines about quicksort. Worst case time complexity is O of n square. It will take full amount of time for its execution in case of O of n square. Best case time complexity, it would be O of n log n. And also average case time complexity would be O of n log n. Space complexity is O of n log n. Again, this is similar to your quicksort algorithm. This algorithm also comes under divide and conquer method. There we again divide the whole array into two subarrays. We do this task till all the elements becomes individual elements of the array. Once it becomes individual elements of the array, at last we start merging. While merging the elements, we actually do sorting. And if you see this diagram, the elements given to you are actually, if you see from bottom to top, you get your actual sorted elements. Your elements are 5, 2, 4, 6, 1, 3, 2, 6. The part of division is not mentioned here. Just imagine this is the last line. The last line, that is 5, 2, 4, 6, 1, 3, 2, 6, is your actual array. The process of process of division, you will get these elements and individual elements of this merge sort. Once it is obtained, it becomes your initial sequence for merging. Now we'll pick phi and 2 and then we'll merge it. But while merging, we'll actually sort it. We are not only merging it, we are also sorting it. Similarly, 4, 6, no need to sort, it is already sorted. 1, 3 already sorted, while merging, 2, 6 already sorted. Now we got 2, 4 subarrays by using this first iteration. In the second iteration, if you go, you will merge 2, 5 and 4, 6. It becomes 2, 4, 5, 6. Whereas in the next subarray, you will get 1, 2, 3, 6. In the last iteration, the last two, these two subarrays will be added and you will get 1, 2, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 6, which is your actual sorted array for this given list of elements. Now, our focus should be only on the time complexity. So we'll go to the time complexities of these algorithms. See here, the worst case, best case and average case time complexity for this algorithm is O of n log n, whereas best complexity is O of n. Okay. Why worst case or average case and best case time complexity is O of n log n? Again, the answer is same, because you are dividing the whole array into two half. Whenever this happens, the function becomes logarithmic. Your answer is log n is the time complexity for it. But during sorting, you are going from one index to the last index. So it is a linear function. It is a combination of both the functions, linear plus or the logarithmic. So it becomes linear function. That's why your time complexity is O of n log n. Have they given the time complexities of this algorithm? Heap sort is very, very important from your exam point of view. They will going to ask you a question definitely on max heap, min heap, and in sorting or using sort. Now, what happens in heap sort? In heap sort, we have to find out the heap tree for the given list of elements. How do you find the tree for a given list of elements? Say the numbers are given to you. Your first job is to find a binary tree for it. After finding the binary tree, to get the maxif or min heap, you have to apply a procedure to find the maxif. In a maxif tree, remember this thing, in maxif tree, just focus on this diagram on the right hand side of this page. This is the diagram for maxif. In maxif tree or in the maxif, the parent is having higher value than its children always. No matter the left hand side and right hand side elements. Now if you see in this diagram, 20 is having higher value than 17 and 14. It is not binary search tree. Please do not mix binary search tree with the maxif. Only one rule of maxif is that the parent element must have value greater than its children, left children and right children. Now if you focus on 17, you will see left side is having 11 whereas right is having 8. Both the children are having lesser value than the parent, so parent must have higher value than his children. So I can say that till now also it is maxif. Just focus on 11, check the values of its children. Left is 6 and right is 1. Both these nodes are having less value than the parent. Again, it is a maxif. Now, if you go to the side of this root node 20, here also 14 is having higher value than 9 and 7. It means that every node, every parent node in the maxif tree must have higher value than the children. This is the simple rule of designing a maxif for any given list of elements. Now there is another part which comes in the heap sort is min heap. We can sort the elements with the help of maxif also. We can also sort the this algorithm Ipsot from Ipsot using Minhip also. So what happens in Minhip? It is exactly reverse of your maxif. Minhip is exactly reverse of maxif. Just focus on the left hand side diagram of this page. One is the root, then 3, below it 7, then below it we have 11, 9, 6, below 4 we have 17 and 8. What is happening here? In Minhip tree, every parent node, simple rule is that every parent node must have value less than the children. Every parent node must have value less than the children. So check here, root node 1 is having value 1, which is less than 3 and 4. That is children. Similarly, if you focus on 3, it is having value less than the children 7 and 6. Similarly, at root node 4, it is having value less than 17 and 8. If you consider on 7, you will see left hand side you have 11, right is 9. The only rule is there in maxif is that every parent node must have value less than its children. That's it. So this way we can create minhip and maxif for the given list of elements. So they may give you a random list of elements and ask you to design a maxif for it or a minhip for it. So try to solve some problems on designing maxif and minhip. Take some random elements, 6-7 elements, and design a maxif and design a minhip for that particular elements. So what happens in the heap sort? Actually, they are not given, but I'll tell you. After obtaining, see, in heap sort, we have to always obtain the maxif tree. Consider these are the elements given to you. Focus on the right side of the diagram, and these are the elements given to you, and your job is to sort these elements in ascending order. Correct. So what happens here? First, we have to obtain the maxif. We are sorting the heap sort using maxif. Okay. So first we get the maxif tree. Once you get the maxif tree, we label all these elements, all these nodes with the indices. Right node, root node is 0. Its immediate children will be labeled as 1, 2, then 11 is 3, 8 is 4, 9 is 5, 7 is 6, this is 8, and this is 9. Correct. So how many elements are there total? 0 to 8, you have to mention it. See, there are total 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So the, if there are 9 elements into your tree, your indices should go from 0 to 8. So we will give all the indices to the respective nodes. And after giving the indices, you have to, all these are unsorted elements, right? Now you have to swap. You have to swap the last unsorted index with the root node. Correct. So one guess swapped with the root node 20. It means that after this, you have obtained the first sorted element at the root node. Correct. The element which is appearing at the root node is your first sorted element. Once it is obtained, we will ignore the root node because it is already sorted, and we will only focus on the remaining diagram. And we have to check the remaining diagram, whether the remaining diagram is your maxif tree or not. If it is not a maxif tree, then again recursively you have to repeatedly you have to obtain the maxif tree, again give the labeling to each and every node, to all unsorted elements. Please do not give index now to the sorted element, just ignore that element which is already sorted. Give the indices to only unsorted elements and repeat the procedure till the last element gets sorted. One video of mine is also available on YouTube. I'll share that link to you. You can go through it and check how to sort the elements using HipSort. I'll share some of the links to you today. Just refer those videos, and we'll come to an end of today's lecture because the time is now 2:43. I will take your attendance. Before that, if you want to ask me any question, please ask. Just we'll complete with the time complexity of short before this, if ending this today's lecture. They will not going to ask you write a program on so and so. Okay, they will going to ask you how you calculate the time complexity and space complexity in case of algorithm subjects. Okay. the time complexity for Hipshot is again O of n log n, because here also we design a binary search tree or a binary tree, correct? So in binary tree also there are two halves of every node. One is left part and another is right part. Again, it means that the division task is there in Hipshot. So it is logarithmic function. For sorting, you are going from one element to another element till the last element of the tree. So again, it is linear function. It is the combination of linear function and logarithmic function. That's why your time complexity is O of n log n. Correct. So you have to remember this, the four lines. That is worst case time complexity, best case time complexity, average case time complexity for Hipshot and space complexities for the Hipshot. I'll share this document with you. Please go through this document.